Welcome to Cambridge Forum discussing Rex Appeal, the amazing story of Sue the dinosaur. I'm Pat Zirke, director of the forum. Cambridge Forum is now in its 36th season of bringing you the live public programs for discussion of the issues and ideas that are shaping our world. In the summer of 1990, a team of paleontologists from the Black Hills Institute made the discovery of a lifetime, unearthing the largest intact T-Rex skeleton ever found. Named Sue, the T-Rex launched a hailstorm of lawsuits, FBI investigations, and controversy in what is popularly known in the media as the Bone Wars. Who should own such treasures? Individuals, museums, or the government? How has Sue's discovery changed the field of paleontology? Peter Larson is the founder and president of the Black Hills Institute of Geological Research. He and his crew have now excavated 7 Tyrannosaurus rex, along with thousands of other fossils that are on display in natural history museums around the world. Journalist Kristen Donnan has investigated legal cases for NBC's Unsolved Mysteries and served as health and science editor for McCall's magazine, in addition to writing fiction and nonfiction. Little did she know, when setting out to do a story on Peter Larson's ordeal, that it would evolve into a 10-year odyssey, during which the reporter and her subject fell in love, married, and divorced. Rex Appeal, the amazing story of Sue the dinosaur that changed science, the law, and my life, is the culmination of their journey and the basis for our discussion. Welcome to Cambridge Forum, Peter Larson.
Thank you, Pat. Well, this all began back in 1990, as Pat mentioned, when Susan Hendrickson, a volunteer who was working with us at our Duckbill Dinosaur Quarry, went out searching on the neighbor's ranch. The ranch was owned by Morris Williams. And she came back to me, and she held in her hand 2 pieces of bone that she wondered what they were. And she held them out to me, and I had never seen the inside of a T-Rex vertebrae before, but when I looked at those, I knew that was exactly what I was looking at, in part because theropod dinosaurs, meat-eating dinosaurs like Tyrannosaurus rex, are very, very closely related to birds, and it's the same type of structure, this honeycomb structure that I saw inside these vertebrae, that we find in bird bones today. Well, needless to say, I was very excited because we had never dug a Tyrannosaurus rex before, and so I rushed back to the scene with her, to the site that she had picked up these 2 bones, and I noticed the first thing, where the ground was literally scattered pieces of bones all over the place. And up on the bank, about 7 feet above above the floor of the cliff face, we saw about 8 feet of scattered broken bones coming out of the bank, and immediately began digging after, we immediately began digging after we checked on the land status and made sure that Morris Williams did indeed own that piece of property. We got permission from him to dig and began the excavation. When we had finished, what we had found was the most complete, best preserved, and largest Tyrannosaurus rex skeleton that had ever been found. And once we had actually begun the dig, I started naming it Sue in honor of Susan Hendrickson, the gal who found it. Well, we took our nice find home. We began preparation on it. We worked for 21 months on cleaning this skeleton. In the meantime, we had actually excavated a second Tyrannosaurus rex skeleton, and then the unthinkable happened.
Kristen Dunnan continues the story.
You might think that picking up dinosaur bones would be the most amazing thing you could do, and finding the biggest T-Rex ever would be enough. But this story has another twist to it that was even more bizarre and exciting and wild and crazy. And that was one day when Pete came to work, 21 months after he had brought that dinosaur home, his building was surrounded by police tape, the kind you see on TV shows. 35 federal agents, some of them with guns, police officers, the U.S. attorney, land management agents, all kinds of people were there, and they said that they were coming to pick up Sue. They had a seizure warrant, and they had brought about one bag of plaster and some 2x4s to load up 10 tons of rock and bone. Not a great plan. The Institute personnel were, of course, shocked and dismayed and unhappy, and they got over that quickly and decided that the biggest priority was making sure that Sue was safe. And they spent the next 3 days packing her for shipment so that her journey was safe. As soon as she went on her way, they sued the government for the return of their property. Almost as good an idea as marrying your subject. So, it turns out that the seizure was the spark for two different legal cases. One was the custody battle that began when Peter sued the government. There are four entities that were fighting over the dinosaur. One was the government, who said that the dinosaur belonged to the U.S. government. The second was the Institute. The third was the landowner, who sort of changed his mind about the sale that had taken place when he had sold the dinosaur to the Institute. And the fourth was the Cheyenne River Sioux tribe. The Institute had bought this dinosaur from this man whose land was owned outright, but he lived within the borders of the reservation. And so that was the problem, it turned out. That piece of land was in trust with the government, which is an old arrangement between the government and Indian tribes, and allows for the government to oversee real estate transactions so that the Indians were treated fairly generations back. Nowadays, the benefit for a Native American person is that he or she doesn't have to pay taxes. So it's a perfectly fine arrangement, and it shouldn't really matter about collecting fossils, because oil and gravel and things like that can be sold from those kinds of lands in trust with no problem. However, that was why the government seized the dinosaur, and that started this government's investigation into the workings of the Institute. Eventually, long story, many, many years, many subpoenas, more seizures, handwriting samples, grand jury, everything. The Institute, the three primary owners of the Institute and some of their employees and associates were charged with 39 counts, a total of 153 charges of wrongdoing, stemming from the concept that they would have taken fossils from the wrong place, whether it be tribal property or something like public lands, Bureau of Land Management or Forest Service. And then if they drove a fossil across state lines, interstate transportation of stolen goods, and if they had called the Smithsonian and said, hey, I heard you were looking for this for a Triceratops, and we have one. Wire fraud. And if the Smithsonian or some other place would have bought that fossil and they had cashed the check, money laundering right there. So it was this RICO indictment, and it was way out of control. That case went on for several years. It was a very difficult and horrifying process for all of us. And eventually, almost all of it went away. The jury knew, and I interviewed them, most of them. A couple didn't feel like talking. But all the rest said, you know, we knew these were just regular people, and perhaps on a couple of occasions, and they may have been in the wrong place by accident. But certainly they weren't having a conspiracy. And in fact, the indictment was centered on seven different sites in their whole career of collecting maybe a million fossils seven times. They may have been or may not have been in the wrong place. In the end, Peter Larson was convicted of the failure to fill out forms, two customs forms, which witnesses for the government said he didn't have to fill out, but the judge said he did. 2 years in prison, 2 years probation. Meanwhile, Sue was also in home confinement of her own. She was behind bars, as it were. And we still hoped that Sue would come back to the Institute. Of those four entities, the government finally dropped its claim because, ridiculous, the tribe lost its own claim in its own court. And it came down to that sale between Morris Williams and Peter Larson. So we thought, hey, there's going to be a silver lining in this cloud. But same judge. Judge said dinosaur was real estate. And as such, that Mr. Williams would have had to have permission to sell the dinosaur, and he didn't. And so the sale was null and void, and so the dinosaur went back to him. And then he auctioned it at Sotheby's. We had a friend, a benefactor, a businessman named Stan Adelstein, who went to Rapid City, or from Rapid City, South Dakota, to New York to try to buy that dinosaur again. And after about 7 seconds, he was outbid, and that dinosaur sold for $8.36 million. The Field Museum bought it, and she's happy there, and God love her. She's in good hands. She's well taken care of. Pete has visitation. And it was a happy story. It turned out McDonald's and Disney helped the Field Museum buy that piece for that museum. So, happy ending, not as happy as we would like it, but she's a good dinosaur and she's in a happy place. Meanwhile, Pete, who hated all that legal stuff to begin with, had only one relationship with Sue, and that was a scientific one, and it continues.
Well, there certainly were some good things that happened about this. One thing is I had 2 years of time to really work on my science. And so I was able to do a lot of things that perhaps in that period of time that I wouldn't normally have been able to do. My wonderful friends and colleagues sent me papers, scientific papers, that I could actually keep there in my cell, if you will, and I was able to still work on things. In fact, actually put out a couple of papers while I was in the slammer, and worked on various things. One of them was, of course, the respiration of theropods, of meat-eating dinosaurs, and looking at how closely they are related to birds. I don't know how many of you know, but birds actually have a one-way respiratory system. They have a system of air sacs, which invades the bones, which is why we have these little hollow places and these little honeycombed areas in their vertebrae. And it did so in theropod dinosaurs, in meat-eating dinosaurs, and in the long-necked dinosaurs we call sauropods as well. But what in birds, what this allows them to do is with the system of air sacs, which acts actually as a system of bellows, which pushes air from the rear of the lungs through the lungs out the front, so that their lungs are constantly bathed in fresh air, the same system that allows birds to have powered flight at 30,000 feet, where we know they go because we occasionally suck them into jet engines. But at that point, we could not survive. We as a mammal, our lungs are made in a very, very inefficient manner when we compare them to birds. So this is one bit of information that tells us what a high metabolic rate these meat-eating dinosaurs had. I worked on a number of other things, including what's called craniokinesis, which is the ability of bones within the skull to move. We know this from snakes, where they are able to actually swallow things bigger than their own heads. We know this in certain lizards, and we also know this in birds. It's that thing that allows birds, baby birds, to open not only their lower jaw, but their upper jaw as well, so that when their parent feeds them, there's all kinds of a big target there for the mother and father bird to hit. It turns out that Tyrannosaurus rex, the second skeleton we collected, called Stan, which is the a second type of Tyrannosaurus rex skeleton, was found by Stan Sackerson, and that skull was completely disarticulated. We could look at how those bones interacted and moved, and it turns out that T-Rex skulls had a bit of kinesis to them as well. They could actually move, which would be useful in swallowing really, really big objects like huge lawyers, for instance. And it also is useful in providing shock-absorbing system for the skull bones and the teeth when this animal was biting something really, really hard. Like it actually bit through leg bones of other dinosaurs, so we know that they bit into hard things. This would help save their teeth, which are only replaced about once every 2 or 3 years. We looked at running speeds, and yes, T-Rex can run. Comparing them to a chicken is not a good idea. You can't just blow up a chicken, which we bred for very big muscles in a small animal. We should look at something more like ostriches and emus, which at least more closely approximate the size of a T-Rex than a chicken does, and aren't genetically engineered like chickens are to get great big drumsticks. And we looked at, in particular, I think the thing that really interested me the most and trying to find an answer to is, can we tell the sex of a theropod dinosaur? Because even while we were digging this dinosaur, which had named Sue before a shovel ever hit the dirt, we started thinking about, well, is Sue a boy or a girl T-Rex? And was there really any way to tell? Well, it turns out that my friend Ken Carpenter from the Denver Museum of Natural History had actually written the only scientific paper looking at T-Rex and seeing if he could tell the difference in skeletons. Now, what he noted that there were two different kinds of skeleton. There's a more robust, a more largely built animal, more muscular animal, which was Sue, and a more lightly built animal, like the one we call Stan. And although the bones are almost the same length, they definitely don't have as much mass, so that they actually held up a heavier animal. Muscle attachments were bigger, lots of other little things like the curved humerus in the more robust form. And he looked at the pelvis, which is a good place to start, because that's, of course, the way we tell in mammals whether they're male or female, particularly in humans. And he found that the ischium, one of the bones in the pelvis, was actually more divergent in the robust form. And so he said, well, that would give a little bit more room for eggs to pass through the cloaca, and thus this form could be female. Well, that didn't sit too well with my male mammal chauvinist colleagues who feel that, and you know, guys are supposed to be the bigger ones. But if we look at the world of animals as a whole, we find out that females usually are bigger. Female black widow spiders eat their smaller mate after copulation, and it goes through the entire invertebrate kingdom. It goes through fishes the same way. Females are larger than males, and even in turtles and snakes and some mammals, like female baleen whales are larger than their male counterparts, as well as hyenas. And if you think about it, it doesn't really make sense that the male should be larger, because the females are born with a set number of eggs, which not only carry the genetic information, but they also carry nutrients for the developing embryo. And so that if we have a female that is smaller than the male, it really doesn't make a lot of sense, because the male actually produces sperm by the millions every day. So I looked at a number of other different characters involved in these different skeletons, the robust and the more lightly built form. And it turns out that not only does the robust form have a deeper pelvis, it also has a much wider pelvis. And I looked at reproductive systems, and it turns out that theropod dinosaurs, meat-eating dinosaurs, always lay eggs in pairs. That means two eggs pass through the cloaca at once. They had to have a wider pelvis. So the robust form has a much wider pelvis as well. There's a couple of other differences in their structure, including a difference in chevron size, which is a little spine that's at the base of the tail. But I think, to make a long story short, when Sue was finally put on exhibit and I got to see the clean specimen, I noticed a very, very interesting pathology or healed injury on the base of her tail. And there we saw the spines, the dorsal spines of the caudal vertebrae, the tail vertebrae, are actually have fingers of bone stretching out to each other in a way not displayed in the more gracile forms. And those fingers of bone stretching out to each other are a result of a tremendous strain on the base of that tail. A large weight, for instance, being placed on there many, many times could cause this growth, extra growth of bone, holding those ligaments tighter and tighter because of the extra weight that's there. And that is very, very consistent with the weight of a copulating male. So I think we have some really, really good evidence that tells us that Sue indeed is female. And I think with that, maybe we could have some questions. Or
you're joining us at Cambridge Forum, listening to Peter Larson and Kristen Dunnan discussing Rex Appeal, the amazing story of Sue the dinosaur. I'd like to ask you first, Peter. You talked about some of the papers you published about dinosaurs, T-Rex in particular, based on some of the evidence that you found in Sue. Can you put your discovery of Sue in context in terms of what was known about Tyrannosaurus rex before you discovered Sue? You've discovered seven other new Tyrannosaurus rex after your ordeal. You discover them in one place, in the Black Hills Reservation. What do we know now about the life of Tyrannosaurus that you didn't know when you started excavating Sue?
Well, I think the thing that Sue really sparked was a study more of the behavior of these meat-eating dinosaurs, and Tyrannosaurus rex in particular. Not only now can we tell, I think we have good data that shows us what are female and what are male T-Rexes, which help us unwind that behavior. But we know a lot more about how they nested, how that they had contact with their eggs. Their body actually had contact with their eggs. And in theropod dinosaurs, I'm not positive about T-Rex, but it seems that they would have also. We know that they worked in probably in family groups, because buried with Sue, and no one had ever really seen this before, buried with Sue were parts of three other T-Rexes, a smaller male, a juvenile, and a baby T-Rex, all in the same site. And since that, we've looked at, gone back to other sites and found there's at least two other localities where this has happened, where there's more than one buried at once. So rather than the solitary hunter or the solitary scavenger, as my colleague Jack Horner thinks of them, they were a family-oriented animal that probably took both the male and the female to raise their young. And showing that the female is larger also indicates that they were probably monogamous, unlike mammals who get larger because the males get larger because they want to have multiple wives. They fight for that right. Birds of prey, where the females are larger than the males, have to work in concert to raise those young. And so lots of different things about behavior that Sue told us that we didn't know before.
I'd like to ask you a question too, Kristen. You observe this multitude of legal cases as somewhat of an outsider. You said you tried to make yourself an outsider in the book. Why do you think this discovery called down such a multitude of lawsuits and such controversy? And do you see this happening with other archaeological discoveries?
When I asked the assistant U.S. attorney who prosecuted the case why the case began, he said it was because this dinosaur was so huge and so perfect and so important scientifically that it also had some kind of financial and other value. And because of that loophole with the trust issue, he said it was essential for the government to follow up, to double check that all the procedures had been followed correctly. Which sounds like, if that were his real motivation, it seems like he might have called and had a cup of coffee and had a conversation instead of bringing, you know, guns. But I think that there was some bit of truth to that, and it came from the concept that when important scientific discoveries are made, people fight over them, and it also had to do with competition in the scientific community. Peter has the largest private fossil preparatory on the planet. There are people who believe that it's immoral to sell fossils, and that's how his company is funded. He's the place that museums go shopping. And some people think you should never attach money and fossils because for reasons which I understand. The problem with that logic is that all museums started by buying fossils. That's how almost all museums got the things that you go and look at today and the things that people looked at 100 years ago. So in some sense that argument needs to be played out in a different way, but there was a period where people decided that the law had to get involved and people needed to be arrested and things needed to be seized. And the other piece of the answer is that there is no overriding legislation in this country, like there is in archaeology, to govern how paleo finds are worked with from public lands. So most paleontologists collect from private land unless they're publicly funded, and then they might have a relationship with public land managers. It needs to be better than that. And there is legislation that's been fought over and fought over and fought over. And in fact, Peter was on a National Academy of Sciences committee who made recommendations to Congress to get better laws in place. And that was in the 80s, right? Mid-80s. So it's been a long process and it's not finished yet. There's a lot more to do.
You are listening to Peter Larson and Kristen Donnan discussing Rex Appeal, the amazing story of Sue the Dinosaur. The floor is now open for your questions. Please use the microphone in the center.
Hi. Do you think that your long jail sentence was due to a bureaucratic embarrassment?
I think there's probably a little bit of something to that. There were a lot of feelings hurt throughout this case. I was pretty outspoken, as was my lawyer, and I think we hurt some people's feelings. Plus, there was a tremendous expenditure of money on the part of the the Justice Department that needed some sort of justification.
Also, could you say something about the lifespan of a T-Rex? Do you have any idea how long they actually lived and what their growth rate was?
To look at lifespan, we need to look at living animals. Birds and crocodiles are probably the closest living relatives, both of which have pretty long lives, and larger animals tend to live longer. Now, Sue had multiple healed injuries that there's no way she could have gotten them one time and healed from them. And one of them was a broken leg, which was a really interesting thing in a bipedal animal. So she could have perhaps been as old as 100 years old when she passed away. Certainly, you know, 80, 100 years, something like that. And while she didn't just pass away either, she was killed by another Rex. But
dinosaurs don't pass away.
No.
Thanks. Could you either read the prologue or describe the last hour of Sue's life?
The last minutes. Probably be shorter to just describe it. What I think happened in to Sue and her family was that another family group attacked them and murdered them, literally. And she was the reigning queen of that particular territory. And by the time the battle was over, she and all of her young were dead. We found most of her skeleton, and we found the reason she died, and that was from the bite of another T-Rex, literally having the left side of her face ripped off. Now, she was old, probably pretty tough, and there were three younger dinosaurs at least for the marauding band to eat. And so I think that the reason we only found very fragmentary remains of them is because they were literally eaten.
Who collected the $8.6 million? How was the money shared? Who eventually got the profit?
Well, the actual sales price for Sue was $7.6 million. With the auctioneer's commission, it was $8.36 million. And so that Morris Williams, after the auctioneer's commission, got $7.6 million, which he was able to actually get tax-free as proceeds of a trust.
Did the over $200,000 that the Institute put into excavation and preparation, was that ever recouped? And the answer is no. It would have been up to Morris Williams to, out of the goodness of his heart, share that money, and he did not. So not only were those finances lost, but also the Institute spent over $1 million in defense.
And did the American Indians get anything out of this?
The tribe got nothing as well.